The last couple of decades have witnessed a tremendous advance in the field of genetics, and that is really going to revolutionize clinical practice in a big manner. From the start of the Human Genome Project, now we have easy facilities for high throughput genetic sequencing, which can actually provide access to all the genetic assessment and gene assessment for every individual. And these clinical exome or clinical genome expression studies are really presenting a tremendous opportunity in terms of helping clinical care. And there is a need to, however, understand the application and the limitation of these various techniques, which may sometimes cause more confusion than actually providing result. The field of endocrinology has long been influenced by genetic discoveries and has actually led to a number of genetic discoveries, given the insights into different endocrine pathways, and therefore understanding of the effect of genetics on endocrinology and vice versa is quite important. So the first question which often asks is, why do we need to do genetics in endocrinology? What are the real indications that we need to have genetic inputs in endocrinology, and how do we approach those situations? So we'll just go through a few cases and illustrate the importance of genetics. So we have this one-year-old boy who presented with a massive weight of 15 kilograms. This was a rapidly progressive obesity with a significant component of hyperphagia. And this child really poses a major management challenge. Because theoretically, we may talk about lifestyle issues, but what lifestyle issues are we going to address in a one-year-old child who's predominantly on breastfeeding? The child is such hyperphagia that requires up to a liter of milk at night. Obvious clinical examination is not showing any feature of any syndrome, and that really perplexes our mind as to what we are dealing with. And here, I think genetics becomes important to really make a diagnosis and probably headway towards treatment under such circumstances. 28-year-old mother with a past history of having a girl with congenital adrenal hyperplasia, 21-hydroxylase, simple virilizing form. She was really, really concerned about virilization in the earlier girl, which required multiple surgeries, which was not improving over time. And during pregnancy, the major question that the parents often ask is this child affected or not? And this needs to be answered. And without genetic input, it would really be impossible to do so. Now, this is a 9-month-old boy who is absolutely asymptomatic, who has just visited because there is a strong family history of medullary carcinoma thyroid in the family. And there's also a history of pheochromocytoma, based upon which a putative diagnosis of Men's syndrome type 2 has been made. And the parents know very well that there is a very high risk of developing medullary thyroid carcinoma, and along with that, a high risk of metastasis. The big question they're asking is, when should we remove the thyroid? Should it be done now, at the age of 5 years, or subsequently? Again, a clinical question which really needs a significant answer. Otherwise, it becomes a big difficulty. Again, a 3-month-old child, failure to thrive, with huge hepatomegaly, blood sugar of 326 and HbA1c which is high. The child is clearly a case of diabetes, and what treatment options do we have is a major issue. So in a nutshell, genetic inputs in endocrinology are required on multiple instances, be it to identify a genetic basis of a disease, to establish a clear-cut diagnosis, to predict the future and to give a prognosis for that individual, and with a possibility of guiding treatment as far as the genotype is concerned. And this is this targeted pharmacotherapy which is going to be the medicine of future. And over the next couple of decades, hopefully we will have genetic analysis which will really guide as far as treatment is concerned. So we'll focus about these four situations and how, in a case-based manner, we can approach using genetics in endocrinology. So now the next issue comes is, when should we suspect about genetics and when it becomes important? So from a clinical perspective, when we talk about genetic diseases, we are broadly talking about, on one end of the spectrum, are the Mendelian diseases, which are quite rare, quite severe, and have an unusual presentation. But these are very small numbers. So if we talk about obesity, maybe a very few of them would actually have mutations in the leptin gene, the leptin receptor, or the MC4R receptor. So a very small minority, less than 1%, be it type 2 diabetes or be it short stature, would actually have a monogenic or a Mendelian form of inheritance. And that itself has a lot of complications, which we'll discuss later on. But things are much more muddier when we talk about the polygenic varieties, which are quite common, which are mild, and which are usually present in the population. And to detect a genetic etiology and to expect a significant genetic etiology for, let's say, secondary hypertension or diabetes or osteoporosis or short stature, although very common and with a high level of heritability, it's unlikely that there will be one or two genes which are affected. So do we need to do extensive genetic screening in every individual? And that's a basic question. So the first question which should come in the mind of a clinician dealing with a child with endocrine problem is, when should we really think of a genetic disorder? So for that, what we need to understand is, when we talk about Mendelian genetic disorder, we are talking about unusual situation. So if a child is presenting unusually early with an unusually severe phenotype, which is familial and is associated with typical syndromic feature, one has to think of a syndromic cause. So if you have a child who comes to you at 9 years of age with a high standard deviation score of -2.2, which is not much below the parental expectation, there are no dysmorphic features, it will be a waste of money doing unnecessary genetic investigations. But if you have a 4-year-old boy who presents with a remarkable growth failure for height standard deviation score below -5, who has facial asymmetry, who has clinodactyly, you have to think of a possibility of a genetic cause in that situation. Similar example from obesity. So you have a 12-year-old boy with obesity who is obese and tall, which, as all of our endocrinologists would agree, is more of a marker of an exogenous or a lifestyle obesity. The faces are normal, the development is normal. Do we need to really do genetic studies in this case? I would say the answer is emphatic no, because the likelihood of finding a single gene which may be amenable to treatment would be next to impossible. So please don't waste money in these garden variety of cases. But if we talk about the case that we are seeing, that we discuss, the first case in which we have onset around 1 year, which is very early, rapidly progressive disease, which is a marker of severity, and hyperphagia, which will be unusual for this age, definitely we are looking at something which is not a simple exogenous or constitutional obesity. And as per the guidelines of the Endocrine Society regarding evaluation of pediatric obesity, if you have onset below 5 years of age, if there are clinical features of genetic obesity syndromes or extreme hyperphagia, one has to really suspect about genetic situations. So if you have to look at genetic basis, this is one situation which it becomes important. So now, when we have the different aspects, we'll focus on the genetic basis of diseases, and we'll start off again with this case in which we have a early onset, severe and unusual obesity. So what would be the approach to diagnosis? If you talk about the conventional pre-genomic or pre-gene white expressions thing was, we would look at the clinical features, try to match it with obvious genetic syndromes, do some laboratory test. Maybe once we know that leptin deficiency is there, we can check for leptin levels. Try to look at different experimental models and where the child fits in, and then make a diagnosis. This obviously is imperfect in the truest sense of the word. It is often complicated and cumbersome. So now in the genomic era, options could be to look at pedigree analysis, where we can find clear-cut evidence of monogenic obesity. We know some specific genes which are available, so we can look at targeted testing. Or if we don't have idea about the targeted testing, we can actually go ahead now with genome-wide study. And this phenomena will come multiple times in terms of confusion as to whether we should go ahead with a targeted testing or a genomic testing. When we have a tool available which can sequence all the genes at a not so exorbitant price, why don't go ahead with that? Because then we will not miss any particular diagnosis. I think the answer to that lies in the very concept that this is entirely against the basic tenet of clinical medicine. Then why are we really doing any form of clinical examination or evaluation? So if you have a child with, let's say, who comes to you with obesity, you do all endocrine tests. It's the same corollary. So you check for anything from PTH to GnRH stimulation test to glucose suppression test to a testosterone levels. You do all endocrine tests for a condition in which they may not be related. And when you see the results, because there is always a chance of different errors happening, if you order 100 tests, at least 2 or 3 will be abnormal. And the same thing will happen when we actually order a clinical exome or a clinical genome expression study, because we are looking at thousands of genes. There are many variants which are always present, single nucleotide polymorphisms which are present in every individual, and in those individuals it may not have any pathogenic significance. And even if you find something of pathogenic significance, it's very difficult to really extrapolate the clinical relevance of that situation. So rather than causing too much confusion, the genome-wide study should actually be restricted to special situations wherein we are not really looking into any evident cause of that particular etiology. So let's go back to this case and look at what we should do as far as the Endocrine Society guidelines. So this child had a normal development. So obviously, disorders which are associated with abnormal development are excluded. There was no family history and no involvement. So a possibility of a dominant disorder becomes less likely, although it could have been a de novo mutation per se. So that leaves us with a few genes. So in this situation, probably if you focus on these few genes, we will find the diagnosis. But what really happened in this case? And when we come back to this case, evaluation showed that the leptin levels were normal. And it was noted by an astute clinician that there was small subcutaneous calcification in the abdominal area, and mother had features of brachymetacarpia, short hands, and that was suggestive of pseudo hypoparathyroidism. So that led to further evaluation for a possibility of PHP, which showed a borderline calcium, slightly high phosphorus and slightly high PTH level, indicating a possibility of abnormality in the GNAS or the G protein alpha subunit, which incidentally is not only involved in the signaling of PTH, TSH and lot of other peptide hormones, but probably also plays a role in the action of the MC4 receptor, which would in a way provide the basis of hyperphagia in that setting. So even in this day and age of genome-wide expression studies, if we do an astute clinical examination, we can focus and narrow down. And that gives us confidence that there will be role for clinicians, even when we're talking about tests which are available on the drop of a pen, so to speak. So having talked about genetic basis, the next question which often comes to mind is how to make a diagnosis, particularly in the prenatal as well as the postnatal situation. So this was the situation which we are faced with, a mother with CAH, and there is a definite question whether the child is affected or not, and this is a very common situation. So what have been the approaches that can be used in this situation? Conventional approaches that have used are usually biochemical based. So you measure the amniotic fluid 17-OHP, and there are cutoffs which are available which say that if the cutoffs levels are below that cutoff, it's unlikely. If it's higher than that, it's likely to be affected fetus. But remember, these are all biochemical parameters which have limitations, and these cutoffs are also in a way population based, and they may not be relevant as far as specific individuals are concerned. So if you want to be doubly sure, then obviously you need to have a genetic testing in the index case in parents, identify the mutation and do a genetic study on CVS, and then you can make a diagnosis. So as in this situation, the child was found to be affected, and in most situations that we encounter in resource poor countries, rather than going ahead with management, they really wanted to terminate the child, which was their decision in that regards. So clinical diagnosis needs to be supplanted by genetic diagnosis in these situations. There are certain other situations in which clinical diagnosis may be challenging, and confirmation with genetics will also be challenging. in that we had this 2-year-old girl with vaginal bleeding who had recent onset breast development and no pubic hair development. She had multiple cafe olive spots and ovarian cysts with prepubertal LH and FSH levels. So this is a classical picture of Macune-Albright syndrome. And we all know that Macune-Albright syndrome is a G protein disorder in which again the same GNAS1 gene is affected. So somebody sent for the blood report for the GNAS1 gene and that turned out to be negative. So what went wrong in this setting? What we need to understand is that Macune-Albright syndrome is one of the few disorders which is actually a disorder of somatic mutation in which the germ cells are not affected, but it's a post-zygotic mutation. So not all cells will carry that mutation. So the blood cells would may be negative, while if we had done the skin fibroblast culture, look for the mutation, or maybe if we had looked at the ovarian cyst aspiration, we would have been able to pick up the possibility of the GNAS1 mutation. Similarly, we had a 10-year-old boy with obesity who had normal weight till 3 years of age. There was history of infantile hypotonia, feeding difficulty, and after 3 to 4 years, there was significant hyperphagia, rapid progress, and there was small phallic size. A possibility of Prader-Willi syndrome was considered, and a FISH testing was done, which was found to be normal. So what we need to understand is that Prader-Willi syndrome is a disorder of genomic imprinting, in which the disorder presents only if the father's part of that particular gene are either deleted or we have a double maternal part or there are some imprinting defects. So FISH study may not be able to pick up all the individuals who have Prader-Willi syndrome in that setting. The second issue, therefore, as far as genetic diagnosis is concerned, is that we need to look at various possibilities, particularly because we can have phenocopies in which multiple genes can have a similar effect. This is classically observed in the setting of obesity, where we can have problems in either the leptin receptor, leptin gene, or MC4 receptor, or a possibility of a GNAS1 mutation as we discussed. They can all present with a similar picture. So we need to be wary about that. There's also a possibility that the same gene can have multiple effects. So you can have a genocopy as well. We should always be aware that there could be a post-zygotic mutation and getting the particular relevant tissue becomes extremely important in that setting. And finally, we can also have epigenetic modifications of the genome which may alter the expression of that particular gene. So having discussed about the genetic basis and diagnosis, the next issue is about how do we predict or prognosticate a particular individual. So going back to this case, who had a 9-month-old boy with a strong family history of medullary carcinoma thyroid, went to do a surgery. The conventional approach has been to actually look at a possibility of the clinical and stimulated parameters. That approach has had a significant problem because in many situations we are actually missing the boat by the time the parameters become abnormal. And now with a robust prediction model as far as the genotype-phenotype correlation is concerned, which is available for the RET oncogene, we now know if there are high-risk parameters, we should actually go ahead and do a prophylactic thyroidectomy even before 1 year of age. What we need to understand is that the relevance of this genotype-phenotype correlation will be more for individuals in a given family or kindred. The same cannot be done as far as a population-based study, which may be a genetic incidentaloma. So if you have a child who is diagnosed based upon a population-based screening for something else, if you find this mutation, it may not have the same correlation as for the situation that we observe, particularly in the setting of somebody who has a family history of men in this condition. So going back to this case, they found that there was a significant risk of thyroid carcinoma developing and therefore immediate thyroidectomy was considered in this situation. What also needs to understand is that just by establishing a genetic diagnosis, one cannot be sure that this individual will be clearly affected. Because what we need to understand is that there is a concept of penetrance as to the probability of how many individuals who have the gene will actually show the signs of disease, and expressivity in that the expression or the level of the disease may be different for the same genotype for a different individuals. And we all know the role of our environmental effects or epigenetics. The classical example of the environmental effect was noticed in landmark epidemiological studies from Finland, in which a part of Finland, Karelia, was partitioned with Russia. Both countries had, and the individuals had, the same genotype, but they lived in a different environment in these 60 years. And what happened in the last 60 years is that while the Finnish part of the landmass has a very high prevalence of type 1 diabetes, that of the Russian counterparts is 6 times less. So for the same genotype, the environment can make a huge difference. So just by identifying a gene, one cannot and should not say that this is going to be the ultimate effect, because there are a lot of other factors which come into the picture which needs to be considered. So having discussed about identification of genetic basis, making a diagnosis, prognostication, the final issue is about the treatment in this perspective. And that always becomes a very important situation. And we are actually looking at situations in which, based upon genetic analysis, one can really decide about treatment. So maybe if you have a short child coming to you, rather than doing so many tests, you just do a single blood examination and you know there's this gene affected, give that particular therapy. That's not happening in most cases at the moment, but where it has really happened, like in this case of neonatal diabetes, which had been a huge challenge to manage, is something which is there. So conventional approach was to look at C-peptide level in these children, give a trial of insulin, maybe think of insulin pump, but all of that was really problematic. The genetic approach will be to actually look for the cause, identify the pathogenesis, and then consider treatment in this perspective. So now we know that a large number of individuals who have permanent neonatal diabetes have a potassium ATP channel defect, and these individuals, particularly those who are less than 6 months of age with severe form of disease, are responsive to sulfonylurea. So identification of the genetic mutation, as in this index case, could often result in switching over to oral medicine, so which is in a way far targeted pharmacotherapy, but we are much more areas to go and cover in this regards. So as far as genetics in endocrinology or any other branch of medicine is concerned, we should always keep our eyes and ear open in an individual with early onset, severe abnormal features and familial association. Think of a genetic etiology. Always think of possible confounders in the form of penetrance, expression, genocopy, phenocopy, somatic mutations, and do a stepwise approach which will really result in significant improvement. Thank you.